नमस्ते, वेरी वॉल वेलकम टू बीटीयू ई शिक्षण प्रोग्राम। आई डॉक्टर दाक्षायणी आर पाटिल, एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर, बीएमएस कॉलेज ऑफ आर्किटेक्चर, बैंगलोर, एक्सटेंड माय ग्रीटिंग्स टू वन एंड ऑल। वी आर डीलिंग विद द कोर्स बिल्डिंग सर्विसेज 3 एंड द कंपोनेंट्स ऑफ मैकेनिकल वेंटिलेशन एंड एयर कंडीशनिंग सिस्टम्स इन दिस पर्टिकुलर लेक्चर सीरीज under the code 18ARC63 for the PR 6th semester under BTU for the session 2021. So this is in accordance with the BTU e-learning platform, a wonderful initiative by the university. So under the building services, modules 1 and 2, of which module 1 is completed in the previous sections, we are proceeding with module 2, that is air conditioning systems. This is a glance at the syllabus content, the references listed in the syllabus, and few additional also. So module 2, the current lecture is number 4. Under air conditioning systems, and we were looking at the types of air conditioning systems. We started off with window units, also called as unit ACs or room ACs, in the previous lecture number 3. So lecture 4 will address split air conditioning unit, and we will look at the salient aspects of split AC in terms of the components, the types available, installation directions or installation guidelines. Also we will look at NBC, National Building Code 2016, regulations or norms towards the installation of split AC and the advantages. So split AC as a nomenclature points, the AC unit is split into two parts. So what we will do is we will package the condenser and compressor in one package, and the evaporator and the fan and the filters in the other package. So just to recollect at this point of time, air conditioning processes are based on the fundamental principles of refrigeration cycles, vapor compression refrigeration cycle, which has mainly the four components: evaporator, compressor, condenser, and the throttling device. And the processes of expansion, condensation, compression keeps happening in a cyclic manner. The refrigerant, that is a fluid that runs across all these components, is the heat exchange fluid or media to transfer heat from one space to the into the system and giving it to the outside. So in the split AC, which is a form of unitary AC. So unitary ACs, what do they do? They are catering to the requirement of a single space or a zone. They are not as complex or as large as the central air conditioning systems, which we are going to see in the forthcoming lectures. So in the split AC, we divided the entire package into outdoor component and indoor component. The outdoor component is going to have the condenser and compressor, and it is placed outside the building. Indoor package, the component, will have the fan and the evaporator mainly, also with the filters and the front panel, thermostat, and the interface, user interface. And they are available up to 50 tons. But the most popular tonnage would be up to, say, 5 ton, where you use one outdoor and one indoor. But split ACs also have the added advantage that for a given single outdoor unit, you can provide multiple indoor units catering to multiple rooms or spaces. That is one of the wonderful advantages of split AC. So what we are looking at to the left side is our indoor space, the room. To the right side is the outdoor space. The indoor unit is inside the space. It is installed on the wall in this case. The red arrows indicate the warm, hot used air of the room entering the system, and the blue indicates the cooled, cleaned air given back or supplied back to the system. So the indoor unit converts the warm indoor air to cold indoor air, conditioning the room. So what happens between and the outdoor unit, if you see, it has a condenser which transfers the heat to the outdoors. So the red arrow only shows that it is giving out the hot or warm air to the outside environment. And between the two have to be connected. We have the electricity piping, wiring. Then we have the refrigerant. The blue one indicates the cold state of the refrigerant, and the red one where it gets heated up. So it is going to take the heat from the room air, refrigeration cycle basically, happening between the two indoor and the outdoor components. So in the indoor component, the red arrows indicating warm air entering the system, it is called as the return air grill. So return air grill will comprise of filters, basic filtering. Behind that is the evaporator or the cooling coil. Behind the evaporator is the evaporator fan. So the fan comes into action once you switch on the AC. It is going to create the suction power to pull in the warm air of the room into the system. As it passes through the filter, it is going to clean the air. And then the clean air is going to pass through the evaporator, where it gives the heat from itself to the refrigerant. So that is a process that happens in the indoor cycle. Outdoor cycle, the condenser is going to give out the heat from the air to the outside. So split AC, two parts, indoor unit and outdoor unit. And what are the components? The indoor unit is also called as fan coil unit, right? Just give me a second. Fan coil unit, and it comprises of evaporator coil or the cooling coil, blower with the motor which is going to run the blower to create the suction power, control panel, air filter, supply and return air grills. Return air grills, the grills which will take in the hot air from the room. Supply air grill, which are giving the cooled, cleaned air back into the room. So two sets of grills. Outdoor unit is going to comprise of compressor, air-cooled condenser, and the condenser fan and motor. Is that clear so far? I will be addressing or taking the indoor unit and the available three types with respect to designing the space. We have three possibilities with respect to the indoor unit or the fan coil unit. It could be wall mounted, it could be ceiling mounted, or it can be placed on the floor mounted, also called as a console model. So these three typologies of indoor units are possible. Now we will look at the wall mounted indoor unit. So if you see in the images, the AC unit, indoor unit is installed on the wall just below the ceiling. You can schematically show that in your answers. So draw the indoor unit, two arrows, and it connected to the outdoor unit via the three sets of pipings that we just spoke about, the refrigerant piping and the electrical cables. right? So when you are deciding on what kind of unit for the particular building, if it is retrofitting in an existing building or in any building, we have to ensure that the wall is able to take the load of the indoor unit. That is very essential. And you have the right direction, ideally the northern direction or east or west, to place the unit. That is a suitable unit. And also we have to see how the ducting is going to stretch out of the indoor unit to the outside. So these aspects have to be kept in mind when we shortlist wall mounted unit for the indoors. Second type is the ceiling mounted. That is, you will mount the indoor unit onto the topmost part of the ceiling. It can either happen directly on the slab, ceiling slab, like in the bottom picture, or it can be embedded in the false ceiling, which is most oftenly done if we have seen offices, etc., where it doesn't hamper the aesthetic of the indoor space. You will embed the unit in the false ceiling, and the front panel will be just seen on the surface of the false ceiling. So that will have the return air grill, outdoor return air, supply air grills, and the control panel. And the pipings will take it to the outside. Outdoor unit may be kept on the sturdy base, or it can be hung on a proper fixture that is hinged on the wall. So again, understanding which type of unit is suitable for the given indoor space has to be decided, keeping in mind the structural ability of the wall or the ceiling and provisions to incorporate the same. And other things, aesthetics, the intended interior look, interior design, the costing, the capacity, possibility of laying the duct lines, the piping is essential. So ceiling mounted, these are images of the false ceiling embedded ones where the flat panel flushes with the finish of the ceiling, false ceiling. Doesn't hamper much of the look, only this much is seen. So along with the light, it can embed it in the false ceiling. The third type is the floor mounted or the console model. So it will be placed on the floor and connected to the outdoor. It is seen, it comes in different shapes, sizes. Why this is come out, probably in older buildings where you do not know if the wall or the ceiling is able to take up this kind of a unit load, or there is provision to hang it, we adopt the indoor floor mounted console model. Easy on the floor, and also it can be, if required, mobile, move easily from one point to another based on the ducting capacity. So floor mounted is normally used in older buildings or where retrofitting in old buildings. There are sleek models of different sizes. This is Mitsubishi model, which comes in with a short height. So you have a window and you want to place it there. The tall ones wouldn't probably suffice there. So we can, you can do a quick study on these various models and specifications, and where and how they are compatible with the given interior of the space. There's another which is sitting on the wall at a lower level, at the comfort level or occupied level. It protrudes. The lines are embedded, concealed. We also have something called as mini split with a concealed design. So they can concealed in the sense all the other aspects like ducting and extra items are not easily visible to the interiors. They are concealed and not evidently perceived. So they do not impact the design of the interior space. Very subtly they camouflage with the wall or with the ceiling and hidden per se. So wonderfully adapted to various such uses, various sizes, various ways of placing the front supply air grill and the return air grill. If you see, you can explore more on the given link there. Now regarding how we have to actually design or place them, the indoor and the outdoor units are connected by refrigeration tubing, right? They have to be connected. The refrigerant has to flow between the evaporator compressor condenser, otherwise it's not able to undertake the cooling or the heating, and the electrical cables. Liquid line and suction lines of the refrigerant have to be laid out at site. They are not factory assembled. So once you decide where your indoor unit sits and where is the outdoor unit going to sit, we need to install the liquid and suction line of the refrigerant. So manpower and man skill is required there, labor force, and the service provider either himself or her provides it, or you have to arrange for the same. Now the most important aspect that we have to keep in mind is the distance between the indoor and the outdoor unit has to be as small as possible. Least distance means less energy loss, less energy consumption, and more efficiency. Why so? Longer the distance, longer the pressure drop in the liquid line and suction line, giving rise to temperature increase. Pressure rise, temperature increases. So that increases the load on the AC. So to avoid these kind of pressure losses and energy inefficiency, we have to target or place the units in such a way that the distance between the two is the smallest possible. Now few more installation guidelines as per NBC 2016, volume 2. You can all check it out and go through this often to get acquainted with it. The outdoor unit ideally should be placed on a solid bearing, a proper platform created for the same, so that it takes the weight and the vibration. Now compressor and condenser are going to do most of the work in the unit, right? And the air is flowing through the system, the refrigeration is flowing, the air especially, the turbulence is going to create vibration. So it is essential that a solid bearing platform base is required to be created for the same. You'll try to locate the outdoor unit in such a way that the hot air that is discharged from the unit, from the condenser side, or the sound due to the same do not disturb the surrounding rooms, the occupants using the spaces around the unit. So logically, the location has to be such that the hot air discharged from the unit, from the condenser side, and the sounds evolving do not disturb the surroundings per se. In the course of providing cooler cleaner indoors, it shouldn't happen that it is contributing to the noise concerns of the space. The units have to be installed in level and plumb, clean, neat, leveled on the surface, and sitting straight. The units securely should be fastened to the building structure if they are supposed to be standing on the wall angles. So keeping it intact to avoid the mishap due to the vibration of the unit and the weight concerned. The outdoor unit should be in such a way that we will try to evade or avoid strong winds, harsh sunlight, rain concerns, or the possibility of creepers, plants growing on it, or birds and animals, squirrels, etc., impacting it. To some extent, it does happen, so you can't always watch out. But while placing it, at least a logical decision has to be taken to avoid these impacts on the unit. Shall I move on? We should give sufficient clearance for the maintenance of the units at the back sides. Maintenance is an expected activity in any of these kind of equipment whatsoever. So a proper clearance or access to maintenance is essentially to be given. So we need to leave that much space. Sufficient space for air passage around the unit for air inlet and air outlet has to be thought of. The unit power cords and inter-unit wire at least to be 3 meters away from any other gadget such as TV or electronic equipment to avoid interference in the remote controller of the AC plus the AC impacting the TV and the other gadget. So two-way consideration is essential. So to be created in such a way that it doesn't hamper the existing gadgets or possible location of the gadgets in future. The refrigerant piping system, copper pipes, shall be pressure tested at a pressure of 21 kgs per square centimeter on the higher side and the lower threshold up to 10 to be tested and maintained. And this has to be done as and when the maintenance is scheduled. The pressure shall be maintained on the system for a minimum of 12 hours to configure, to calibrate and confirm that the system, the pressure system is, this is a very important thing, otherwise the refrigerant pressure drops beyond the lower level. It is going to be highly inefficient, draw more power to give unit ton output of the air conditioning. So NBC definitely suggests this kind of a calibration. Now I have sourced this from the Samsung, the service provider, who is a forerunner in this selling ACs. You may have many other sources also, but I thought let us take a look at one of the service provider products and what do they specify. So if you see the indoor unit, it is specified on top 300 mm or more advisable, 125 if you are placing it towards the wall. On either side, basically on either sides, 125 or more. Height is given there from the floor level, so you can decide based on the buffers on the three sides, the piping, the outdoor unit, what is required minimum on the sides, on top or towards the condenser side. So just an indication of how a product would specify. Every product will have its own specification, so NBC advises that any such installations happen as per the product specification, service provider, and in addition the minimum to be adhered to. Now why should we adopt split ACs? What advantages does it have in store? The first important thing is a very interesting and encouraging aspect of using a split AC. The compressor and condenser are outside the room. So we have substantially reduced the noise and vibration levels when we compare it with the window AC. In the window AC, it is right on the window sill, the front and the back. So in split AC, we are keeping the noisy components of the AC on the outside. So it is an advantage. Split AC is easily accessible for maintenance. Suppose for window AC, the person has to come inside the room, and if there's something happening, some activity, meetings or so, it becomes difficult. So at any given point of time, since the unit is outside, easily feasible or accessible for maintenance. Space isn't a concern because now we have this indoor unit which is sleek and can be on the wall or on the ceiling, and it's not that bulky compressor condenser or outside, not a cause of concern. One outdoor unit might suffice multiple indoor units. Another wonderful advantage of using a split AC system, one set of compressor condenser can be used to cool multiple rooms with evaporator in each one of them. Another way of holding the outdoor unit onto the external wall, and that is the piping which is taking the refrigerant pipe into the space, the electrical wiring, grounding and all required. We have the possibility of going in for mini split, multi-split AC systems. So what happens in mini split? Single indoor unit connected to one outdoor unit. So it's a single unit and only one temperature across the home area. So single calibration of the temperature. Multi-split, multiple indoor units connected to single outdoor unit, because that we saw in the advantage aspect. Allows for different temperatures for each room as per their requirement, and the user can control as per his or her comfort requirements. So this is an advantage. Single split AC, it is meant for only one room. One possibility, such as a garage or a outdoor room or outhouse, etc. Right. So to sum up, it is advisable we undertake a quick market survey on split AC units available, and one exercise of comparing at least two products under specific parameters, such as what is the capacity, what is the size, what does the product manufacturer advise as the buffer spaces, what are the types of refrigerant tubing used, what is the refrigerant used, what is the energy consumption, does it have a rating. So under these parameters, compare at least two products, the two is missing there, two or more. All right, that would make a nice relevant study for the given time. So this is what is about split AC. We have seen window AC in our previous section, in the previous lecture. In the upcoming lecture number 5, we will be dealing with other two types of unitary AC, that is package AC and rooftop AC systems. All right. So after that, we'll proceed to the next central AC. So until then, see you during the lecture number 6 ahead. Until then, take care. Bye.